What's good? I got my bro here, Alejandro here. We are here to talk about... Why are you laughing? We're going to keep rolling, whatever. I got my boy Alejandro here. We just chilling and we want to talk to y'all real quick about our top five movies. What up, Alejandro? How you doing?
I'm the random Mexican he keeps around.
What?
There you go, I'm in.
Really?
Yeah.
Why would you say that?
It's a running gag.
Anyway, alright. So what we're going to do in this video here is we're going to talk about our top 5 movies of the year 2021. This year 2021 was full of some interesting films. What do you think, bro?
Oh yeah, it was a great year. Not a good year for video games, but a good year for films.
Yeah, that's true. Video games was a little low. But that's alright, that's alright. We're gonna get the ball rolling, and also it was also a great year to be a nerd as well. I know he's probably not into the nerdy films like I am. That's why I'm the representation of y'all.
Have you seen the background, dude?
I got him into some of these.
True.
I take credit for some of these. But anyway, let's get the ball rolling. Alright, number 5, I'm gonna start the party off with The Harder They Fall. This is on Netflix. This is a dope Western film dealing with this outlaw who finds out one of his enemies had escaped from prison and whatnot, and he's trying to get revenge with him and his crew. It was a pretty interesting concept, and I was not expecting the twist of the end.
Me neither.
I was not prepared for that. I think that film, it really hit me in the heart, especially at the end when it comes to, like, I ain't gonna spoil it, but
you shouldn't even be hinted that there's a twist. Just watch it, pretty much.
Dang.
No,
oh well.
No. I mean, it wasn't. It was pretty a good one, though. I was saying.
Yeah, it hit me right here, and I wasn't expecting. I mean, it was a lot of westerns that I watched in my past. My grandmother introduced me to a lot of westerns, and a lot of them had really hit me in the heart. But this one right here really hit me in the heart, and I wasn't prepared.
No, it was a fun flick, very creative too.
Yes, and the soundtrack. Good God. Dude, yes.
When they went to the white town, it was just all white, the whole thing was white. I thought that was very clever.
Yes.
And the town was like so boring and
bland. Yes.
And I don't know. Just,
yeah, everybody's performance was off the chain.
It's a metaphor. But yeah.
Okay.
My number 5 is Last Night in Soho by Edgar Wright. Now, this movie is very different from what he does. He usually is known for his fast-paced editing, comedy, action type thing. This is a very slow, he takes his time with it. And I like when directors approach something different, you know, out of their comfort zone.
That's true.
And they knocked it out of the park. And I think Edgar Wright definitely did. The movie's fun. It's a tribute to the 1960s London. It's almost like Once Upon a Time in London type thing.
Yeah.
And the details that he put in there are amazing. The music is fun and energetic. The mystery is really good too. The performance by both actresses, really good. I mean, just Edgar Wright. Let's just talk about Edgar Wright for a minute. There's this whole sequence where, the main actress, the main character, Eloise, I believe her name is, she has like this shining power that she can like sense, feel, and like relive memories of deceased people. And then they were explaining, and that's fine. We're just in for the ride. We don't need an explanation. I never once questioned why that is. We just go in for it. But when she relives his memories, we see her through her, the actress that plays Eloise, and then back to the Anya Taylor-Joy's character, which I forgot her name right now.
That's okay. That's all right.
But we switch between them and two. Like in Reflection, we see the main Eloise, and then there we see Anya Taylor-Joy's character. And there's this dance sequence where it's all in one take, and it switches between the two characters with every other move. And he did that actually in camera. And he could have just done that. He could have done that like in VFX and like be easier.
Yeah.
But it's been an extensive amount of time to get this right and actually do it in one take.
Nice.
And in camera. And that just speaks like levels of the director, man. The details he puts in this.
Nice.
And the work that people put into it. And the mystery is great. Pretty much someone, the main lead, moves to London. She's trying to, she moves in because she's a fashion. She's trying to study fashion. And she moves into this hotel where someone was murdered. And she's pretty much reliving like what happened to this person. And there is a twist, I will say though. The reason why it's like number 5 is a little lower than the other ones, because as much as I enjoy it, the ending is a little bit cliche and maybe a little bit unpredictable, but it doesn't discourage the rest of the film.
Yeah. So, nice.
Great soundtrack too. Very fun. Check it out.
Nice. And hold on. And let me tell y'all this real quick also. I don't love, I can't speak for him, for all of mine, I can't rate each of them lower than the other one. I love each of them the same level, the same way. There's some I put a little bit above others, but I still have the same love and passion for them each the same way.
True. This was hard.
Very hard as we were trying to put this list together. Anyway, let's move on. All right, number four, and this was hard because I was trying to put some indies in here mixed with my nerd stuff, but it's hard. My nerd stuff really won it over. So my number four is going to be Zack Snyder's cut of Justice League. This film, I remember the campaign was starting years ago. Release the Snyder Cut, release the Snyder Cut. And then when we first got hyped that this was coming, like, we lost it. I was like, yo, we're finally going to get it. It was a 4-hour film. What was it, a 4-3
yeah,
ratio?
Yeah, like four something. Yeah, was it?
Yeah, it was like a 4-3 ratio. Yeah, 4-3 ratio. And it was a dope presentation. The visuals are stunning. I love the story. And I got to appreciate Zack Snyder for giving each of these characters of the Justice League a spotlight. In the previous version, we see Superman just do everything. He gave every single person in this film a chance to show what they can do, especially the Flash.
The Flash.
And Cyborg, he was the heart of this movie.
He was, yeah.
Right? I was really impressed by his backstory.
His whole origin, yeah, where he looked
like
giving people
But
money.
By the way, how do you make a football game look like a gorgeous cinematically shot? That was beautiful. That's Snyder, though. That's his definitely
his
strength.
He's
yes.
He's bread and butter.
Yes. And seeing Supes and, oh my God, it was beautiful. All of it was gorgeous. What'd you think, bro?
I mean, it fixes the other one. And no Superman mustache.
Why would you say that?
That alone redeems the movie.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, the visuals are great. Definitely, I'm saying, the side stroke is even better than the other one, too.
I love this. Who was it? Tom Hulkenberg?
Yeah.
Was it Tom Hulkenberg that did the soundtrack? It was actually pretty dark. Actually, it actually really matches the atmosphere of the film, really.
Yeah. I mean, I think that the 4 hours may be a discouragement for some people.
Yeah.
It's okay if you split it into parts.
Hold on, let me say this. It is 4 hours, but for those of us that can handle the Lord of the Rings trilogy.
Extended edition.
And that's like 4 hours a piece. This ain't nothing to you. I ran through this film so fast. King Kong.
You saw it multiple times, too.
I did watch it multiple times. Yeah. I was in love. So, and yeah.
If you can, if you have the time, watch the whole thing, but if you can't, don't feel bad. It's okay to break it apart. I know it could be a lot for some people.
Yeah.
But in general, just watch it. So
it's real good. Right, before we go any further, go ahead and hit that like and that subscribe button. I promise y'all gonna enjoy the next stuff that we got. I got coming. I ain't say we. Well, this ain't the last video y'all gonna see without him. He's gonna be in some more soon. But anyway, let's move on to our number. Well, his number.
Yeah, my number.
His number four.
I can't give you my number, but.
His number four.
Cool.
What's your number four, bro?
So number four for me is The Great Nine by David Lowery. And this film, it comes with a little hashtag thing for some people. Yeah. I know this movie is a bit of a slow burn for a lot of people. It could be a bit slow. It takes its time. But trust me, it has a lot of layers in it. And the more you watch it, the more you gonna peel those layers. And that's what I think that's what makes, in my opinion, like those like great films. The ones that you can just like go back and like, wow, I didn't even notice this before.
Yep.
You
know? Yeah, that's true.
And this film definitely has that. And it asks a lot of questions. You know, questions of what it means to be a knight, life, death, you know, what your life stands for. It has a amount of, I can't even freaking think of all the questions that it
has. Yeah.
And it asks, and it doesn't provide answers. And that's up to you, the audience, to figure it out. And that's one of the things that I like about it, because everybody interprets things differently based on where they are in life. And maybe I'm going to have different answers based if I'm older, if I see it later, you know? And that excites me a little bit.
Yeah.
So, this film follows these, I guess it's during King Arthur, right?
Mm-hmm.
King Arthur, one of his knights challenges the Green Knight, which is this, like, almost like tree, supernatural, like, Groot-looking creature. Super powerful. He cuts him, and then he says, okay, now that you cut me or kill me, he comes back to life, and he says, now I have 1 year to train, and now it's my turn to cut you. So pretty much this knight wasted that whole year. He didn't do nothing but, can we say it? Just whoring, drinking, and pretty much just lazing around, And then that year comes and it's time to take that journey.
Yeah.
Pretty much have to prepare for death. I mean, he goes through these trials that pretty much gonna question his character, mm-hmm. his bravery, his knighthood, what he stands for.
Yep.
And he just has to, does he face death or does he run away from it? Mm-hmm. And if he does, what does that mean for the rest of the world or himself, his reputation? Or does he just take the blows like a man and accepts death? You know, those are the kind of questions that the Green Knight offers. And he just has a lot of things about time and what we do with our time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he wasted that whole year he had to train. He just did nothing.
Yeah.
So we got to take that time and do something that means to us. And I think that's one of the great things that the Green Knight offers, is that sort of questions and things, that perspective that gives you people. And again, mm-hmm. it could be a little bit slow burn, but I'm telling you, the journey is definitely worth it.
I think what I love about this film, of course, it being a, you know, kind of a slow burn. A lot of movies nowadays don't take their time anymore.
Mm.
They don't, they just rush, do everything like, what my friend, my homie called, he called it fast food movies.
Oh,
where
yeah,
they
yeah.
just go through it so fast and you ain't get no substance out of the film.
I call it popcorn film.
Popcorn film,
you
that too.
Stick with you and then you get
yeah,
out.
Yeah, it just goes out. This film, this is A24, ain't it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, A24. A lot of their films are strange, but they're so good and in-depth to where it makes you question certain things, especially with this film. Also, when you watch this, though, watch the cinematography.
Oh, it's beautiful.
No, I ain't just talking about just visuals. Each movement, each camera moving, every angle has a reason to it. I'm not going to spoil certain ones, but each of them are part of the Easter egg of what's going on
totally,
in the story.
Yeah, I completely forgot how gorgeous the movie
is. It is very gorgeous.
The camera work and the choreography on this is amazing. I totally forgot the soundtrack. It's going to stay with you even after you see the film.
Yes.
You're going to be humming songs from it.
Yes.
And again, it's every all the elements of film just coming together nicely.
Yes. And I can understand how this film isn't for everybody, but it's good. Every single piece of this film has a Easter egg to it. You have to really pay attention, though.
Multiple watch films, the best.
Yes. Green Knight, yep. All right, number three. This is going to be 007, No Time to Die.
What? Wait a minute.
Yeah, I did.
I mean, I'm not dismissing. That's a good one. It's a fun movie.
Yes, it's very hard.
No, it's a fun movie.
It is fun. This is very hard. I'm going to tell you why. Because this was Daniel Craig's last, very, very last performance.
Or James Bond.
Yeah.
Well, mostly mine, I guess.
Yeah, but this was his last performance as James Bond. This was a great wrap-up to his saga of James Bond. Seeing how this guy is trying to come up... What's the villain's name again? Oh, I forgot the villain's name.
The actor who plays Freddie Mercury.
Yeah. Wow. Anyway, he was a little weak, but it was cool to see this triumph of a story and seeing the sacrifices he made to save, you know, not only his boo, but I ain't gonna spoil who else. But it was a great... And the soundtrack by Hans Zimmer, good God almighty.
He's a busy man and he did good.
Yes, he did an awesome job.
Sometimes with Sancho, you see composers like doing five a year and I'm like, one of them gotta be bad, but
yeah, the film, as usual, visually stunning, very well written. It flowed really well too. I actually wasn't bored at a single part. Of course, yeah, that was beautiful.
No, yeah, that's something that The pacing feels good.
And yeah.
It's like, 12 hours and 30 minute film?
Yeah, but it didn't feel like it. At least not to me. I wasn't bored at all.
No. I mean, no, yes, it's a great film. It's a good send-off to Daniel Craig's mom. I mean, he's been doing this for years now.
Yeah, and it's cool to see in this film, he's trying to stay retired, and the agency supposedly got another 007.
We'll see.
But yeah, nah. That was a great triumph film.
Yeah, and Ana de Armas in it.
Yeah.
So,
you know,
that's a great sequence. I love that the Cuban scene, the action scene.
Yeah, that was beautiful. There's this one scene, I gotta talk about it, when him and his boo is in this car, and I forget the name of the car, but it's a very classy car.
Like Martin.
And he finds out something terrible, and they're running from these bandits, and she was like, what are you waiting for? They're just sitting in the middle of this field, and bro, he lost it. That car was a show out. That was a showdown.
We finally got the gadget car.
The gadget car.
And Daniel Craig, and it was used wisely. It was used good.
Yes, it was. That was beautifully shot. That was beautiful. So what's your number three, bro?
My number three is Nightmare Alley by Guillermo del Toro. So you gotta say it right. So mad respect to Guillermo del Toro. The work he puts into his films before even a frame is shot is excellent, and it shows in this movie. The performance by Bradley Cooper, I gotta say, although I haven't seen all his films, I truly gotta say this is his best one.
You gotta see some of his films, he's amazing.
Oh no, I've seen a lot of his films, like Rocky Raccoon, of course.
I was about to say.
But
what?
But,
boy!
But this is, honestly, this is just really good. Mm. I mean, I've seen some into Guillermo del Toro really work personally with him to make sure the performance, like, and the casting, which is perfect. Everybody's like, almost feels like, you know what they say, born to play this character. So pretty much, Guillermo del Toro, what I like about him is he makes movies that like no one else does.
Yeah, that's true.
And this is practically a film noir, a modern film noir that in the style of the classic film noir. We're talking 1940s, you know? Talking about The Killing by Kubrick, A Maltese Falcon. We're talking about the classic. And it has that, I don't know. I mean, I know he's working on a black and white, but version two, but anyway, let's get to the film. So pretty much, it follows this man who has a bit of mystery. Starts with a mystery question already from the beginning, which we don't get the answers to until later. But that's fine. That's how the film works. But he enters this carnival. He gets a job at a carnival, and he starts to learn like the way they do, you know, the illusions behind it and how they get people and con people, if you will. And then he goes and becomes his own con in a way. And the thing about film noirs is that it reveals the dark side of humanity in some way.
That's so true.
It did back then and it still does now. Still this movie does. Is just as relevant as it was if it would have been made then as it is now, because, I mean, look at the times we're living now. Like, people want to be ahead of each other. And this went to con each other just to get that, you know, that fake hope, that fake illusion. Mm-hmm. That's what this movie is about, this dark side of the man who just wants more and more. He's willing to, like, fool people. I guess he thinks, like, he's smarter than everybody. That's his thing. He thinks, like, he can read everybody. He's just above everybody. And like I say, it's like, the character, honestly, is just, I mean, he's a bad character, but, like, you know, he's a bad human being to the core.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the kind of thing that film noir provides. And he knocked it out of the park. And the set designing, I mean, it takes place in like 1947, I believe, early 1942, around there, during World War II started. And it's just, it's great. It's gorgeous. The story is great. It all leads up to this last frame, dude. And it's gonna haunt you. This last frame, the last performance of Bradley Cooper, the last shot, is gonna stay with you after you see the film. And this is something that I heard he even like emphasized, that he. It's very important for the film, the last shot. And it did, it worked. When I saw it, I was like, it stick with me. I was like, damn. Yeah, that's dark. That's dark. And this is the most darkest Guillermo del Toro has ever been in his whole career.
This film sounds like it's ahead of its time. This makes me want to watch it even more.
It sounds like, we'll see. I mean, I'm excited to see what he does next, but this is his darkest he's ever done. And I'm excited to see where he goes with his career. I mean, no more fantasy, which I love, but this one just falls. Just gives the humans. He always says, the biggest monsters are the humans in his stories. And this is a perfect example of that theme that he's always said, you know, in his stories. Mm-hmm. And it's just.
And I love Guillermo del Toro. He's very good at doing very dark, atmospheric films. His Blade 2 was one of my all-time favorite hero films of all time. It's probably the best Blade. But
it's going to be hard to beat.
That's true. And that sounds good. That film sounds ahead of its time. Number two. This one, y'all, the ones that really know me are shocked that this one is even at number two. But Godzilla vs. Kong, baby. Godzilla vs. Kong. This was the film that I really, really needed. I just wanted to have a good time. It's cool to just see monsters just smash on each other. There's a lot of dark films and stuff that came out this year. But this was something that I really needed to just have a good time. And for those that really know me, know that I am a G-Man fan for life. And to see two of my favorite more of my childhood monsters just clashing each other in this modern time.
Ooh.
With, wait, who did this? And this Warner Brothers and Legendary coming together to create.
Feature.
Yep. To create this big Hollywood blockbuster of two of my favorite monsters just scrapping. This was lit. And I ain't gonna tell y'all who else is in this film. But this film, yeah, was a fun, good time. And also, it was cool to see, I'm gonna say this real quick before you talk. It was cool to see in this film as a whole who the real king is. I'm not gonna tell y'all what happened. But I think that was the basic plot that I got out of this film. When you see them meet and you see them scrap, you get to find out who the real king is.
And I mean, and you know, when I saw the movie, I was like, ain't no way they're gonna let someone be above the other one, you know, gonna make everybody happy. But
yeah,
I'm sure satisfied that they did.
Yeah.
In a way, I mean, yeah, they did.
Yeah, they did. Honest.
Which, I mean, come on. Have you seen it? You know, I mean,
yeah,
come
you
on.
Know. We all know. And of course, the soundtrack. Tom Hulkenberg again?
Yeah, yep.
Dang,
my boy was busy.
He's been busy. He's been on a lot of my films.
He's got a Mad Max soundtrack.
Yes. For those that listen to the soundtrack, I can't say it. It would have been a spoiler of what my favorite track name was.
Oh.
I ain't going to tell y'all. But
just listen to it pretty much.
Just listen to it.
Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, just listen to it. It's beautiful. It's a rocking good time. But yeah, Godzilla vs. Kong. I'm looking forward to see where they take this monsterverse. I'm trying to figure out where they go from here.
Me too. I mean, theories. We got our theory. We're like,
we got our little theories.
We're like, what's the next move? Is there a next move?
Yeah, but where are you going to go from here? This was such a mess. Yeah, it was beautiful. And I rocked it at the theater. I watched it in IMAX. We was all hyped up. Lost it.
No, yeah, watching on IMAX too is great. If you missed it, damn. But I mean, honestly, it was a dream come true. Like, this is something that people have been talking about for so long.
Long time.
And actually seeing it and actually done well. Like, you can actually see the fight.
Yes. Man. And I actually went back and watched the old one before I watched the new one. Just because.
That's a classic, though.
It is a classic. There's a scene. Hold on. There's a scene in the old one that I wanted to see them, like, redo where Kong stuck the tree in his mouth. That was funny. It's funny to look at that now and then see that here. But that was cool to see.
No, yeah, it was a good history. There's a lot of good histories if you're, you know.
Yeah.
Godzilla fan. If you're,
yeah.
You know.
You
if you're a Godzilla fan. If you're a Godzilla fan.
Yeah, if you're a Godzilla fan, this deserves a watch.
I mean, I love King Kong, but let's be honest though.
Yeah, this film was dear to my heart, and it was cool. That's why this list was so hard for me, because a lot of these films were like childhood nostalgia. So yeah,
it was a good year for like
it was nostalgia a good films. yes it was
not saying there's nothing wrong with it.
No, nothing's wrong. What is your number two, bro?
My number two is come on by Mike Mills. And the last film Mike Mills did, it was 20th Century Woman. And it was about, sort of like a biopic, about his childhood and the relationship with his mother. And now, after like a few years of like 2016, he does a new film that also deals with parenthood, which I find interesting. That's why I figured I might as well point it out. But this also, during the film, special shout out to mothers. But the movie is about Joaquin Phoenix's character, forgot his name. And it's not when I first saw the trailer, I thought it was like a lonely father and son story, you know? But it's actually his uncle and his nephew's story, which I find interesting. So a little twist to the whole genre of, you know, parenthood. But his mother is in there, but it's mostly about him taking care of his nephew and reconnecting with childhood, parenting. You know, he keeps questioning, like, how come you're alone? How come you're a kid? Like, how come you don't have anybody? And, you know, he keeps, like, avoiding that. And he also, in a way, he's also, through his son, he's also reconnecting with his sister and what happened with their mother, the whole conflict between them. And this Joaquin Phoenix, I mean, after his performance with Joker, he's always gonna be delivering. But, I mean, he was like this, man. You can't see, but he was skinny, man, Joker. And here, he gained weight for this, bro. I don't know if that was just him, like, being older.
Yeah.
But he... From going from that to that, that's some Kristen Bell shit.
Yeah, it is. That's true.
But I can see that he's very, you know, like he has kids now. I can see how this movie could really, don't know, I can see how he took from like Joker to like this indie film. But enough about that, the technical stuff. So this film is really heartwarming, man.
Nice.
You know that I mean, we talk about it, but you know that I don't be crying in no movie, man.
Look, like, did it, what, go ahead.
No, it didn't got me to cry, but there was times when I was like,
to see him so bad, because every time he's like, no, nothing hit me. Not even the Lion King hit him, y'all.
No, this movie, man, I was like the Grinch. My heart grew like 2 inches, man. Like,
2 inches, that ain't big enough.
Oh, I don't know, 2 meters, I don't know meters or inches.
That ain't big enough.
Pause, but. No, but No, like, there was a scene in this movie where I felt like something in my heart, man. I could count those movies with the palm of my hand, man, and this is one of them. It's a very heartwarming movie about parenthood and, you know, childhood and reliving those memories. And I don't know, just very heartwarming. Just thinking about just like, you know, and the score is simple, but like, it does the job done. It's
Who does the score?
I can't even remember.
Oh, okay.
He usually like he does like indie. Like,
oh, he does indie stuff.
Okay. I don't have like the proper name. I'm sorry, dude. But
and what studio did this one? Was it
824? It's an 824 movie, I guess.
Yeah.
Shout out 824. But it's just a very heartwarming story that follows like these people reconnecting and dealing with, you know, parenthood and the sacrifice of parents do to like make sure that, you know, we're nice and happy and that we, you know, we don't see all the things that goes on.
Yeah.
Because the mom. Her husband has like he's going to like mental, he has like mental issues and he doesn't want the son to see that. But the son, you know, he ain't dumb. He knows that there's things going on and he's asking all the big questions and, you know, questions that we all trying to figure out too as adults.
Yeah, that's true.
And even the emphasis is deemed by having the main guy interview like kids. His job is like have like a radio. He's like a radio host and he's interviewing kids about like the future, like being real kids, like real life, almost like a documentary style. Real life kids about how it is to grow now as a, you know, being a kid in the modern times and the struggles and the environment they live in. And it's just a really, really, really good, simple shots, nothing too crazy, just static and just let the scene roll, little moments, you know?
Nice.
Little human moments. And
that's one thing I like about A24 and a lot of their films. They really flesh that out a lot. They really show that out a lot.
They take their time.
They do.
And then
a lot of filmmakers don't do that nowadays.
And that's why I love it. But it just takes its time and it's very little, you know, little sequence of moments and people just interacting, being human and having a moment. And
now, I'm trying to understand why films like this don't get a lot of love. Because This is what good cinema is about, you know, storytelling.
That's a whole different video, right?
Show is.
That's a whole different video.
What films qualify for that?
Yeah, but
that is a whole nother video.
Overall, though, I'm glad that they're being made.
Yeah.
I am a little sad, though, that this movie didn't even break even. Not a lot of people saw it.
Yeah.
But I know that people who did saw it, I know they, you know, they appreciate it. I hope that they appreciated the film that was being that they were being witnessing to. And I am bummed out because it just shows that, like, maybe Hollywood be like, it didn't make that much money. Let's not make no more movies anymore. Mm-hmm. So I want these movies to be made more like this. So please.
Watch them.
These kind of films, they deserve love. A lot of love. Because I know the big summer hot Hollywood block. Well, it's been like that for years. Summer block. The summer blockbusters. I always take most of the money, but films like this,
I mean, before even Blockbuster existed, this was how movies were made. It's about, like, questions humane moments.
Make you think.
Yeah, make you think. Everything was like that, and then obviously Big Buster came in, but it was still that, like, that balance of Blockbuster and this, but now it just feels like...
And I can understand why the Blockbusters nowadays make a lot of money, because people just want to escape. They don't want to know about reality all the time, because there's some films that came out this year that, man, or series too, that I'm like, man, do I want to be reminded of this again, or you know, some stuff like that. So I can understand that part, but we still need films like that for sure.
A good balance. I like,
yes,
good, you know, and give people the options, you know. Give people the options.
Yeah,
at least, like,
yes,
have it out there. And A24 has done so far, so I'm happy with at least that being there. But
shout out to A24, man.
That's my numero dos.
Alright, number one. This was hard. This is 100% hard. And a lot of my homies that really know me finds this a shocker, because I know a lot of them thought my number two was going to be my number one. Mm. But this one, I've rewatched this one multiple times this year. That's how good it was. And my number one is going to be... Nobody! Nobody starring nobody? Freaking Bob Odenkirk.
Nobody's your number one?
No, nobody is my number one.
Damn.
See? I told you it was going to shock you guys. Because this film... Okay, first of all, let me start by me saying I'm writing a book, right? And I took a lot of notes from... And Derek Kolstad wrote this film, who's one of my all-time favorite screenwriters. He wrote, John Wick and started the John Wick universe.
Of course.
And I'm writing a book with an action crime thriller kind of violent kind of story. And I took a lot of notes from him. But this film was amazing to me. It was cool to see Bob Odenkirk, who has a background in comedic comedy.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he's done a lot of comedy. Oh, so this is the first time we actually see him do something serious and brutal and gritty. And I think that's another thing that blew me away, to see this actor get out of his comfort zone.
Oh, yes, yes.
And try something new. And it do borrow elements from John Wick, but it is the same writer. So
I thought you were talking about the writer for a minute, like he's been doing.
No, I'm talking about Bob Odenkirk.
Hey, better call
Saul. No, Bob Odenkirk. Yeah, he did a lot of comedy stuff. Yeah, so it was cool to see him get serious and try something new. And what's cool about the story and this plot is when you mess with a man's family, you mess with him. And what is cool is that you see him as the story unfolds, how he uncovers his old tactical side, because he was just trying to lay low and chill and relax. Mm. But people keep messing with him. Again, where the John Wick influence comes in, where he's trying to relax, but you get to see how it uncovers and shows his tactical side, all that stuff. And he, as a father, he's making crazy choices, questionable choices.
Ooh.
He's barely on time, barely take out the trash. He can't take out the trash on time. He's a family man, but under that, you get to see another layer of him. He's a little bit of an assassin, he's a gunman, blah, blah, blah. Bob Odenkirk really blew me away with this.
Did they kill his dog, too?
it's past that.
I mean, how's the action, though? I mean, I feel like...
The action, the choreography, the script is absolutely beautiful. It's epic. It blew me away a lot. I really, really enjoyed it, man.
Check it out now.
Bob... That's it. I'm pulling it out. I gotta show y'all this. Because Bob blew me away. Look at this. Look at this. Can't hear it. Look at this.
You gotta show the back too, bro.
Look at this. Bob really, really killed it. And they asked him throughout this movie, who are you? I'm nobody. But it's a very beautiful... Very beautiful film. I was really blown away by Bob Odenkirk, and I really hope they make another one. Great job, Derek Kolstad.
Nice.
Beautiful.
Now I really gotta check it out.
Yeah, yes you do.
You know I got it. You were there when I bought it, but
yeah, I'm sorry.
Due to scheduling, it will happen though. It will happen. I will see it though. I mean, it's your number one. Holy shit.
Yeah, I know a lot of people were shocked, but yeah, Bob Odenkirk really blew. I rewatched this one probably the most this year. I really blew this movie up. It was beautiful.
Did you like refire this week too recently?
Huh?
Did you like fire this week last week?
Actually, yeah, I did. When I finally got my PS5 and I finally could watch my 4K disc, yes, I did watch it again.
First one.
Yeah, this is the first one that I actually put in my 4K player.
You always remember the first one.
Yes, always. And I also, one thing I always love to take note from this film is that everybody's like, when they know who he is, they're afraid of him. Again, another John Wick influence kind of a thing. When they know who he is, they're afraid of him. That's the kind of story I'm trying to write with my own character. Mm. You know, showing that intimidation. You know, you mess with the right one. You know, kind of a deal. So, yeah. Nobody. Beautiful film.
So, I'm thinking he's back.
Y'all don't know. If y'all don't know that reference, yeah.
So.
What's your number one,
my
bro?
Number one. Minari.
Yo! Steven Young is in
here,
right?
In there,
oh, okay, yeah.
Also,
did I say his last name right?
Yeah, Minari.
Glenn. I'm just playing.
Minari is my number one. And it's interesting because this movie well, it came out on Sundance, I think, in like 2019, right before COVID hit. One of my friends went to Sundance Film Festival. He saw it, he was like, bro, it was the best one in there. Yeah. And I was like, oh shit, I gotta see it. Like, I remember I saw a trailer, I was like, ooh, it was good. And again, A24. You might see a pattern going on.
Yes, you do.
My choices.
Yes, you do.
But, and then, interesting, because it came out January of this year, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
But yet it won, like, stuff at the Oscars. By the way, the Oscar has no power over my decision. They know they're just fucking good.
Yeah.
So first of all, let's break it down. Well deserved, by the way, the awards they got. they came out this year. And it follows an immigrant family from South Korea. They start to, the father bought a farm in Arkansas, I believe. And he brings the whole family from California to here to pursue the American dream. And that already, you know, that already makes it a personal film for me, because I'm sure you can notice my accent, but, you know, it's just about the struggles and the sacrifice that a family has to go through for that little dream, you know, that
see
we all believe.
See how deep this movie is, and for a person that don't have no tears coming out of his, do y'all see this?
I love those, man. I love them.
See?
But, you know, it's just the sacrifice. And it reminds me of, that's the thing that like, I love the most about movies that inspire me. And this movie honestly inspired me to, like, write about my own, like, childhood and, like, things I went through. Because the director, his name escapes me right now. I'm sorry, dude. But the director based a lot of this story on, like, his childhood. You know, his dad did bought a farm in Arkansas. And he's all, like, going through this, like, process of telling those memories and making this character. Obviously, there's fiction and there's a structure he has to follow and mm-hmm. a story he has to tell. And he does that well, greatly. And, I mean, it's just, and it's shot in, like, this very, like, documentary kind of style, like, this handheld cam, which gives it that, like, realism touch. And it's a beautiful film. It has a lot of standout moments, a lot of metaphors with mm-hmm. even the title itself, the Plan Minari, what it stands for, and all the characters. It even has a lot of funny moments because it follows a kid, the youngest kid, with his grandma there. Because at first he has him, he comes from like South Korea, so she's, and he's like Americanized because he grew up in America.
Yeah.
So I think when she comes in, he's like, she smells like South Korea.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. Like, I don't like eating that, the food that she makes. And he starts to like, slowly, like, you know, really, like, the roots.
Yeah.
You know? And that's what Minari's applying, you know, the roots of where mm-hmm. you're from and the cultural difference. Mm-hmm. And the fact that everybody, at the same time, like, just like, because it also shows, like, one of his friends of them, the young kid, is like this neighbor, this white boy, this little kid, you know?
Yeah.
He meets up at church. And it just shows his dad, too. And then, like, everybody, no matter what color you are or where you're from, like, everybody's trying to have that little struggle to, like, be better, to be, like, elevate, you know, everybody's trying to get the American dream no matter where you're from. And like, everybody goes, maybe not to the same struggles, but everybody goes through something
mm-hmm.
to be better, you know. And
yeah.
And it's important to have it with like the people that you love, in a way, family, you know.
Yeah.
they're always there. And it does, this farm does break the family a little bit, because the dad's the one who wants to have it. And mm-hmm. the mom's like, let's go back to California. Everybody's there, our doctor's there. Like, we know everybody. Because the kid's sick. The young kid, he's sick. He can't, like, he has, like, a heart problem.
Yeah.
So, wow. And the dad's like, no, like, we gotta do this. You know, we're putting all our savings on this. You know, he's mm-hmm. putting everything he got on this. And if he fails, like, it's a bust. And the wife's like, no, let's go back. And there's this whole moment where this whole, I don't want to say before it ends, but, like, it's all wrapped up nicely. You know, it has like probably the most, my favorite thing, just Steven Yeun's performance. It's just him smoking on the field by himself, contemplating things. Oh yeah,
great actor.
He's been really kicking it.
Yes,
like,
he has
kicking it. I mean, like, he's been really killing it, man.
Mm-hmm.
And overall, it's like a mix of English and Korean film, so it has subtitles in there. I don't know if that's like a recent people don't. I know some people don't watch movies because subtitles. So that's a damn shame, but
that's a whole other video too.
But honestly, like, if you could like Bong Joon-ho, so like, if you could just get that little wall over it, you get to experience some amazing films, and I truly believe that. And he's one of them. And it's just a good, heartwarming movie that just brought me back, you know.
Dope, man.
I don't know if Come On, Come On has something to do with being a number two, and also being about like childhood. I don't know if it has anything to do in common. Mm-hmm. That's a whole different video. That's a whole meme.
But again, it goes back to what we were saying earlier, you know, nostalgia, thinking, you know, going back to our childhood. Yeah. I think that's probably why we each chose these films.
Yeah, and I gotta say a special shout out to the soundtrack. I know his name is Emily? I don't know. The composer. I'm sorry, dude. You're honestly, I don't think you're gonna see this, but you're one of my favorite new composers right now.
Dude. Hold on, you can look up his name. Come on, we're gonna get it right here.
Emily? Mozzeri.
Emily Mozzeri.
Emily Mozzeri, yeah. Which composed the score for Last Black Man in San Francisco. Again, simplicity is something that people always say they want to do in film, but it's hard to pull off. And this film pulls that off, and the score as well. It's a short 33-minute soundtrack, but what it offers elevates, like, just the movie to the next level. And the scenes that it play on, it just elevates it. And, like, you can't go wrong with simplicity, man. The score works. The performances are amazing. Movie's beautiful. Directing is great. The story, it's all perfectly nice circle, you know, the way, you know, conclusion.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a great film. It's a great film. It's top tier right there.